be a knight. First, you must believe that the bread you see on the altar is true God and true man, the creator of heaven and earth. Second, once you take up your knightly service, you must exercise more self-restraint than you were accustomed to doing before. Third, you should not care about worldly honor. Rather, I will give you divine joy and everlasting honor. Hearing this and pondering these three things to himself, he heard an evil voice in his mind making three proposals contrary to the first three. It said, "If you serve me, I will make you three other proposals. I will let you take what you see, hear what you like, and obtain what you desire." When he heard this, he thought to himself, "The first Lord bade me to have faith in something I do not see, and promise me things unknown to me. He bade me abstain from the delights that I can see, and that I desire, and to hope for things of which I am uncertain. The other Lord promised me the worldly honor that I can see, and the pleasure that I desire without forbidding me to hear or see the things I like. Surely, it is better for me to follow him, and to have what I see, and to enjoy the things that are sure, rather than to hope for things of which I am uncertain." With thoughts such as these, this man was the first to commence the desertion from the service of a true knight. He rejected the true profession, and broke his promise. He threw down the shield of patience at my feet and let the sword for the defense of the faith drop from his hands, and left the sanctuary. The evil voice told him, "If, as I said, you would be mine, then you should walk proudly in the fields and streets. That other Lord commands his men to be constantly humble. Therefore, be sure not to avoid any sign of pride and ostentation." While that other Lord made his entrance in obedience, and subjected himself to obedience in every way, you should let no one be your superior. Bend not your neck in humility to another. Take up your sword to shed the blood of your neighbor and brother in order to acquire his property. Strap the shield to your arm and risk your life for the sake of winning renown. Instead of the faith that he holds out, give your love to the temple of your own body without abstaining from any of the pleasures that delight you. While the man was making up his mind and strengthening his resolve with such thoughts, his prince laid his hand on the man's neck in the appointed place. No place whatsoever can harm anyone who has a good will, or help anyone whose intention is wicked. After the confirmation of his knighthood, the wretch betrayed his knightly service, exercising it only with a view to worldly pride, making light of the fact that he was now under a greater obligation to live an austere life than before. Countless armies of knights imitated, and still imitate this knight in his pride, and he has sunk all the deeper into the abyss due to his knightly vows. But, given that there are many people who want to rise in the world and achieve renown, but do not manage to do so, you might ask, are these people to be punished for the wickedness of their intentions as much as those who achieve their desired success? To this I answer you, I assure you that anyone who fully intends to rise in the world, and does all he can to do so, in order to gain an empty title of worldly honor, although his intention never achieves its effects due to some secret decision of mine, such a man will be punished for the wickedness of his intention, just as much as the one who does manage to achieve it, that is, unless he rectifies his intention through penance. Look, I will put to you the example of two persons known well enough to many people. One of them prospered according to his wishes, and obtained almost everything he desired. The other had the same intention, but not the same possibilities. The first one obtained worldly renown. He loved the temple of his body in its every lust. He had the power he wanted. Everything he put his hand to prospered. The other was identical to him in intention, but received less renown. He would willingly have shed his neighbor's blood 100 times over in order to be able to realize his plans of greed. He did what he could, and carried out his will in accordance with his desire. These two were alike in their horrible punishment. Although they did not die at exactly the same time, I can still speak of one soul rather than two, since their condemnation was one and the same. both had the same thing to say when body and soul were separated, and the soul departed. Once having left the body, the soul said to it, "Tell me, where now are the sights to delight my eyes that you promised me? Where is the pleasure you showed me? Where are the pleasant words that you bade me use?" The devil was there and answered, "The promised sights are no more than dust, the words are but air, the pleasure is but mud and rot. Those things are of no value to you now." The soul exclaimed then, "Alas, alas, I have been wretchedly deceived. I see three things. I see him who was promised to me under the semblance of bread. He is the very King of kings and Lord of lords. I see what he promised, and it is indescribable and inconceivable. I hear now that the abstinence he recommended was really most useful." Then, in an even louder voice, the soul cried out, "Woe three times, woe is me that ever I was born. Woe is me, that my life on the earth was so long. Woe is me, that I shall live in a perpetual and never-ending death. Behold what wretchedness the wretched will have in return for their contempt of God and their fleeting joy. You should therefore thank me, my bride, for having called you away from such wretchedness. Be obedient to my spirit, and to my chosen ones." Christ's words to the bride, giving an explanation of the immediately preceding chapter, and about the devil's attack on the aforementioned night, and about his terrible and just condemnation. Chapter 9. The entire span of this life is but as a single hour for me. Therefore, what I'm telling you now has always been in my foreknowledge. I told you before about a man who began the true knighthood, and about another who deserted it like a scoundrel. The man who deserted from the ranks of true knights threw down his shield at my feet and his sword at my side, by breaking his sacred promises and vows. The shield he threw down symbolizes nothing other than the upright faith by which he was to defend himself against the enemies of the faith, and of his soul. The feet on which I walk toward humanity symbolize nothing other than the divine delight by which I attract a person to myself, and the patience by which I patiently bear with him. He threw this shield down when he entered my sanctuary, thinking to himself, "I want to obey the Lord who counseled me not to practice abstinence, the one who gives me what I desire, and lets me hear things pleasant to my ears." This was how he threw down the shield of my faith, by wanting to follow his own selfish desire rather than me, by loving the creature more than the Creator. If he had had an upright faith, if he had believed me to be almighty and a just judge and the giver of eternal glory, he would not have wished for anything but me, he would not have feared anything but me. But he threw down my faith at my feet, despising it and counting it for nothing, because he did not seek to please me, and had no regard for my patience. Then he threw down his sword at my side. The sword denotes nothing other than the fear of God, which God's true knight should continuously have in his hands, that is, in his acts. My side symbolizes nothing other than the care and protection with which I shelter and defend my children, like a mother hen sheltering her chicks, so that the devil does not harm them, and no unendurable trials come upon them. But that man threw away the sword of my fear by not bothering to think about my power, and by not having any regard for my love and patience. He threw it down at my side as if to say, "I neither fear nor care about your defense. I got what I have by my own doing, and my noble birth." He broke the promise he made to me. What is the true promise that a man is bound to vow to God? Surely, it is deeds of love, that whatever a person does, he should do out of love for God. But this he set aside, by twisting his love for God toward self-love, he preferred his selfishness to future and eternal delight. In this way he separated himself from me, and left the sanctuary of my humility. The body of any Christian, ruled by humility, is my sanctuary. Those ruled by pride are not my sanctuary, but the sanctuary of the devil, who steers them toward worldly desire after his own purposes. having gone out of the temple of my humility, and having rejected the shield of holy faith and the sword of fear, he walked out proudly to the fields, cultivating every selfish lust and desire, scorning to fear me, and growing in sin and lust. When he reached the final end of his life and his soul had left the body, the demons charged out to meet him. Three voices from hell could be heard speaking against him. The first said, "Is not this the man who deserted from humility, and followed us in pride? If his 2 feet could take him up even higher in pride so as to surpass us, and hold the primacy in pride, he would be quick to do so." The soul answered him, "I'm the one." Justice answered him, "This is the reward of your pride. You will descend handed by one demon down to the next, until you reach the lowest part of hell." And given that there was no demon who did not know his own particular punishment and the torment to be inflicted for every useless thought and deed, neither will you escape punishment at the hands of any one of them, but share in the malice and evil of them all. The second voice cried out saying, "Is not this the man who separated himself from his professed service to God, and joined our ranks instead?" The soul answered, "I'm the one." And justice said, "This is your allotted reward, that everyone who imitates your conduct as a knight will add to your punishment and sorrow by his own corruption and pain, and will strike you at his coming, as though with a deadly wound. You will be like a man afflicted by a severe wound, indeed like one afflicted by wound upon wound, until his whole body is full of wounds, who endures intolerable suffering, and bewails his fate constantly. Even so, you will experience misery upon misery. At the height of your pain will be renewed, and your punishment will never end, and your woes will never decrease." The third voice cried out, "Is not this the man who exchanged his creator for creatures, the love of his creator for his own selfishness?" Justice answered, "It certainly is." Therefore, two holes will be open in him. Through the first the re will enter into him every punishment earned for his least sin up to his greatest, inasmuch as he exchanged his creator for his own lust. Through the second there will enter into him every kind of pain and shame, and no divine consolation or charity will ever come to him, inasmuch as he loved himself, rather than his creator. His life will last forever, and his punishment will last forever, for all the saints have turned away from him. My bride, see how miserable those people will be who despise me, and how great will be the pain they purchase at the price of so little pleasure. As God spoke to Moses from the burning bush, Christ speaks to the bride about how the devil is symbolized by Pharaoh, present-day knights by the people of Israel, and the virgin's body by the bush, and about how present-day knights and bishops are, at present, preparing a home for the devil. Chapter 10. It is written in the law of Moses, that Moses was watching over the flocks in the desert, when he saw a bush that was on fire without being burned up, and he became afraid, and covered his face. A voice spoke to him from the bush, "I have heard of my people's suffering, and feel pity for them, for they are oppressed in harsh slavery. I who am now speaking with you am," that voice heard from the bush. "I have heard the misery of my people. Who are my people if not Israel? Using this same name I now designate the knights in the world, who have taken the vows of my knighthood, and who should be mine, but are being attacked by the devil. What did Pharaoh do to my people Israel in Egypt? 3 things. First, when they were building his walls, they were not to be helped by those gatherers of straw who earlier had helped them in making bricks. Instead, they had to go themselves, and gather the straw, wherever they could throughout the entire country. Second, the builders did not get any thanks for their labor, despite their producing the number of bricks set them as a goal. Third, the foremen beat them harshly whenever they fell short of their normal production. In the midst of their great affliction, this people of mine built 2 cities for Pharaoh. This Pharaoh is none other than the devil who attacks my people, that is, the knights, who ought be my people. Truly I tell you that, If the knights had kept the arrangement and rule established by my first friend, they would have been among my dearest friends. Just as Abraham, who was the first to be given the commandment of circumcision, and was obedient to me, became my dearest friend, and anyone who imitated Abraham's faith and works shared in his love and glory, so too the knights were especially pleasing to me among all the orders, since they promised to shed for me that which they held most dear, their own blood. By this vow they made themselves most pleasing to me, just as Abraham did in the matter of circumcision, and they purified themselves daily, by living up to their profession, and by taking up the practice of holy charity. These knights are now so oppressed by their wretched slavery under the devil, that the devil is wounding them with a lethal wound, and throwing them into pain and suffering. The bishops of the church are building two cities for him just like the children of Israel. The first city stands for physical toil and meaningless anxiety over the acquisition of worldly goods. The second city stands for spiritual unrest and distress, inasmuch as they are never allowed to rest from worldly desire. There is toil on the outside and restlessness and anxiety on the inside, rendering spiritual things a burden. Just as Pharaoh did not supply my people with the things necessary for making bricks, or give them fields full of grain, or wine and other useful things, but the people had to go and find them for themselves in sorrow and tribulation of heart, so the devil deals likewise with them now. Although they toil for and covet the world with their inmost heart, they are still unable to fulfill their desire and sate the thirst of their greed. They are consumed on the inside with sorrow, and on the outside with toil. For that reason, I pity them their sufferings, because my knights, my people, are building homes for the devil and toiling ceaselessly, because they cannot get what they desire, and because they worry themselves over meaningless goods, although the fruit of their anxiety is not a blessing, but rather the reward of shame. When Moses was sent to the people, God gave him a miraculous sign for three reasons. First, it was because each person in Egypt worshipped his own individual god, and because there were innumerable beings who were said to be gods. Therefore it was fitting that there should be a miraculous sign so that, through it and by the power of God, people would believe that there was one God, and one creator of all things, because of the signs, and so that all the idols would be proved worthless. Second, a sign was also given to Moses as a symbol prefiguring my future body. What did the burning bush, that was not consumed, symbolize if not the virgin who conceived by the Holy Spirit, and gave birth without corruption? From this bush I came forth, assuming a human nature from the virginal body of Mary. Similarly, the serpent given as a sign to Moses symbolized my body. In the third place, a sign was given to Moses, in order to confirm the truth of coming events and to prefigure the miraculous signs to be done in the future, proving the truth of God to be so much the truer and more certain the more clearly those things signified by the signs were in time fulfilled. I'm now sending my words to the children of Israel, that is, to the knights. They need no miraculous signs for three reasons. This is, first of all, because the one God and creator of all things is already worshipped and known through Holy Scripture as well as through many signs. Second, they are not now waiting for me to be born, because they know that I was truly born and became incarnate without corruption, inasmuch as Scripture has been completely fulfilled. And there is no better or more certain faith to be held and believed than the one that has already been preached by me and by my holy preachers. Nevertheless, I have done three things through you by which it may be believed. First, these are my true words, and do not differ from the true faith. Second, a demon went out of a possessed man at my word. Third, I gave a certain man the power to unite mistrustful hearts in mutual charity. Therefore, do not have any doubts about those who will believe in me. Those who believe in me believe also in my words. Those who savor me savor also my words. It is written that Moses covered his face after speaking with God. You, however, do not need to cover your face. I opened your spiritual eyes so that you might see spiritual things. I opened your ears so that you might hear the things that are of the Spirit. I will show you a likeness of my body as it was during and before my passion, and such as it was after the resurrection, as Magdalene and Peter and others saw it. You will also hear my voice as it spoke to Moses from within the bush. This same voice is now speaking within your soul. Christ's delightful words to the bride about the glory and honor of the good and true night, and about how the angels come out to meet him, and about how the glorious Trinity welcomes him affectionately, and takes him to a place of indescribable rest as a reward for, but a little struggle. Chapter 11. I told you before about the end and punishment of that knight, who was the first to desert from the nightly service he had promised me. I will now describe for you by way of metaphors, for otherwise you are unable to understand spiritual things, the glory and honor of him who first manfully took up the true nightly service, and manfully kept at it to the end. When this friend of mine came to the end of his life and his soul left his body, 5 legions of angels were sent to greet him. Along with them there also came a multitude of demons, in order to find out if they could lay any claim to him, for they are full of malice, and never rest from malice. A bright clear voice was then heard in heaven, saying, My Lord and Father, is not this the man who bound himself to your will, and carried it out to perfection? The man himself then answered in his own conscience, Indeed I am. 3 voices were then heard. The first was that of the divine nature, which said, Did I not create you, and give you a body and soul? You are my son and you have done your father's will. Come to me, your almighty creator and dear father. An eternal inheritance is owed to you, for you are a son. Your father's inheritance is owed to you, for you have been obedient to him. So, dear son, come to me then. I will welcome you with joy and honor. The second voice was that of the human nature, which said, Brother, come to your brother. I offered myself for you in battle and shed my blood for you. You, who obeyed my will, come to me. You, who paid blood for blood, and were prepared to offer death for death and life for life, come to me. You, who imitated me in your life, enter now into my life, and into my never-ending joy. I recognize you as my true brother. The third voice was that of the Spirit, but the 3 are 1 God, not 3 gods, that said, Come, my knight, you whose interior life was so attractive, that I longed to dwell with you. In your exterior, conduct you were so manly, that you deserved my protection. Enter, then, into rest in return for all your physical troubles. In return for your mental suffering, enter into a consolation beyond description. In return for your charity and your manly struggles, come unto me, and I will dwell in you and you in me. Come to me, then, my excellent knight, who never yearned for anything but me. Come and you will be filled with holy pleasure. Afterward 5 voices were heard from each of the 5 legions of angels. The first one spoke, saying, Let us march ahead of this excellent knight, and carry his weapons ahead of him, that is, let us present to our God the faith he preserved unshaken and defended from the enemies of justice. The second voice said, Let us carry his shield ahead of him, that is, let us show our God that patience of his which, although it is already known to God, will be even more glorious, because of our testimony. By his patience he not only bore adversities patiently but also thanked God for those same adversities. The third voice said, Let us march ahead of him, and present his sword to God, that is, let us show him the obedience by which he remained obedient in both difficult and easy times in accordance with his pledge. The fourth voice said, Come and let us show our God his horse, that is, let us offer the testimony of his humility. As a horse carries the body of a man, so his humility both preceded and followed him, carrying him forth to the performance of every good work. Pride found nothing of its own in him, which is why he rode in safety. The fifth voice said, "Come and let us present his helmet to our God," that is, let us bear witness to the divine yearning he felt for God. He meditated on him in his heart at all times. He had him on his lips, in his works, and yearned for him above all things. Out of his love and veneration he caused himself to die to the world. So, let us present these things to our God, for, in return for a little struggle, this man has deserved eternal rest and joy with his God for whom he yearned so much and so often. Accompanied by the sounds of these voices and a wonderful choir of angels, my friend was carried to eternal rest. His soul saw it all, and said to itself in exultation, "Happy am I to have been created. Happy am I to have served my God whom I now behold. Happy am I, for I have joy and glory that will never end." In such a way did my friend come to me, and receive such a reward. Although not everyone sheds his blood for the sake of my name, nevertheless, everyone will receive the same reward, provided they have the intention of giving their lives for me, if the occasion presents itself, and the needs of the faith demand it. See how important a good intention is. Christ's words to the bride about the unchanging nature and eternal duration of his justice, and about how, after taking a human nature, he revealed his justice through his love in a new light, and about how he tenderly exercises mercy toward the damned, and gently teaches his knights mercy. Chapter 12. I'm the true king. No one deserves to be called king except me, because all honor and power come from me. I'm he who rendered judgment upon the first angel to fall through pride, greed, and envy. I'm he who rendered judgment upon Adam and Cain as well as upon the whole world, by sending it the flood due to the sins of the human race. I'm the same one who allowed the people of Israel to come into captivity, and miraculously led it out with miraculous signs. All justice is to be found in me. Justice always was and is in me without beginning or end. It does not at any time grow less in me, but remains in me true and unchangeable. Although at the present time my justice seems to be somewhat gentler and God seems to be a more patient judge now, this represents no change in my justice, which never changes, but only shows my love the more. I now judge the world by that same justice and that same true judgment, as when I permitted my people to become slaves in Egypt, and made them suffer in the desert. My love was hidden prior to my incarnation. I kept it hidden in my justice like light obscured by a cloud. Once I had taken a human nature, although the law that had been given was changed, justice itself was not changed, but was all the more clearly visible, and was shown in a more abundant light, in love through God's Son. This happened in three ways. First, the law was mitigated, since it had been severe because of disobedient and hardened sinners, and it was difficult, in order to tame the proud. Second, the Son of God suffered and died. Third, my judgment now appears to be farther away, and both seems to be postponed out of mercy and to be gentler towards sinners than before. Indeed, the acts of justice concerning the first parents or the flood or those who died in the desert seem rigid and strict. But that same justice is still with me, and ever has been. However, mercy and love are now more apparent. Earlier, for wise reasons, love was hidden in justice, and displayed with mercy, albeit in a more hidden manner, because I never carried out, and never do carry out justice without mercy or kindness without justice. Now, however, you might ask, if I show mercy in all my justice, in what way am I merciful toward the damned? I will answer you by way of a parable. It is as if a judge were seated in judgment and his brother came along to be sentenced. The judge says to him, "You are my brother and I'm your judge, and, although I sincerely love you, I cannot nor is it right for me to counteract justice. In your conscience you see what is just with respect to what you deserve. It is necessary to sentence you accordingly. If it were possible to go against justice, I would willingly take your sentence upon myself. I'm like that judge. This person is my brother, because of my human nature. When he comes to be judged by me, his conscience informs him of his guilt, and he understands what his sentence should be. Since I am just, I reply to the soul, figuratively speaking, and tell it, you see all that is just for you and your conscience. Tell me what you deserve. The soul answers me then, my conscience informs me of my sentence. It is the punishment due to me, because I did not obey you. I answer, I, your judge, took on myself all your punishment, and made your danger known to you as well as the way to escape punishment. It was simple justice, that you could not enter heaven, before atoning for your guilt. I took on your atonement, because you were incapable of bearing